Welcome back to Computer Science E75. This is Lecture 3 Sequel. So let's get the most important question out of the way tonight. There will not be pizza. So for any of you who came perhaps for the first time this week hoping, I'm afraid there's nothing. But let's talk about dynamic websites a bit more. So you'll recall when we started the course, we neither had a forum nor did we have this list of recent posts on the front of the website. And in fact, we first had the forum for a couple of days, but then I personally got rather tired of logging into the forum just to see what the recent messages were. I thought it'd be much better if we could have a sort of one-stop shopping place for at least information. So we wanted to integrate some of these headlines of recent posts to the course's forum into the course's website. So how did we want to go about doing this? Well, some of you have discovered a little popular orange-colored icon next to an acronym on the course's forum, which is namely what? RSS. So how many of you here use RSS readers of some sort? Okay, so about half. And for those of you who haven't used RSS, it stands for, among other things, really simple syndication. And this is just a fancy way of saying it's information in an XML file, but in a fairly standardized XML file. And really, you see RSS being increasingly used by news sites, New York Times, Slashdot, Engadget, any of these popular tech sites in particular, so that folks don't have to proactively log into the website every day or, you know, for some of you, every hour to see what the most recent articles are, but rather can have the information pulled from some client directly to your own computer. So Outlook has plugins for this, Google Reader is a popular option, and there's innumerable other RSS readers. But the nice thing for a course like this and for a world like ours, a LAMP-based environment, there's really good XML support you've seen already within PHP. And so in fact, doing something like this turns out to be pretty darn simple, because if you have available these RSS feeds, you can very easily integrate data into your own website. And so I thought we'd begin with a quick look at this. So here's the course's forum. And there's RSS links all over the place. And I'm going to be most interested, let's say, in the topmost one there, next to the forum's name itself, because this RSS link, as you'll see in a moment when I click on it, looks like this. So this is IE's rendition of a RSS file. However, if you have certain settings turned on, you'll actually see a much prettier version of this file, because the latest browsers tend not to show you raw XML. But if it's RSS, they actually beautify it with their own built-in style sheet of sorts. But this is XML, and it looks like there's a fairly inferable structure here. It looks like the root element is called RSS, then there's a channel element, and then there's title, description, a bunch of stuff, and then there's a whole bunch of item elements, which might actually remind some of you of your own menu.xml formats for all those items in a pizza menu. And fortunately, the types of fields that can appear with these elements spec that for RSS 2.0 specifies exactly which elements must appear in this file and which elements can appear in this file. And you've seen folks like Apple and other entities actually using RSS these days, but adding their own attributes and elements so that they can extend the functionality, so to speak, of RSS. iTunes, for instance, uses RSS with a whole bunch of iTunes-specific stuff in there. But the takeaway for now is that you have some really nicely semantically tagged data in this file. And we've already seen using XPath and the simple XML API that it's pretty darn easy to get at this information. So my goal at hand was quite simply to get the titles of the most recent messages into the course's website and just display links to them so that I could just myself, and ideally some other folks too, could follow the links off the website and go right to those messages without having to search for some of the new content. So how does one go about doing this? Well, let me go ahead in here and log in to the course's website. Let me go into, let's make a new demo directory here for a moment for tonight's purposes. And let's see, how about I go into, let's see, let's chmod this 755. And now I'm going to go ahead and open up a file called demo.php. All right, I'm going to open my PHP tags there. I'm going to go over to the website and make sure this thing actually exists, cs75.net/demo. OK, excellent. There's nothing there yet, because I haven't so much as saved anything. So let's see what we can do. Well, it turns out if I want some very simple structure here, I'm not going to bother for tonight's purpose. I'm more interested in just getting some interesting work done here. So we have here now the basic building blocks for a web page. And let's have this devoid of PHP for a moment. And just to prove that this is actually happening live, hello will be the only contents of this page for now. Save it, refresh, and hello. All right, so now we're Lecture 0, my first web page. Now let's spice things up a bit. So I want to display ultimately all of the headlines from the RSS feed. Each of the news items or the forum posts, recall, seem to be in what element? What's the name of the element? Just to be clear here. So an item. So I really want a list of a few items. It looks like all these items, if you can sort of follow the indentation, are children of channel, of which there's generally only one. And then channel is a child of RSS. So the path we're thinking about here is /RSS/channel/item, and then a whole bunch of items. So that's what we want to iterate over. How do we begin to actually use something like this data? Well, recall that PHP makes this very simple. And just to keep things clean, I'm going to put a bunch of my logic just at the top of the file here, just to draw our attention to it. I'm going to get out the XML using the simple XML API. And then what's the easiest way to read in the contents of an RSS file, or more generally, a URL on the web? I'm sorry? So I think the constructor for simple XML API doesn't API, simple XML element, actually needs to take in a string, as I recall. But you know, fortunately, PHP has most everything save the kitchen sink. File get contents, beyond just reading in the contents of a file on the local file system and returning it as one huge string, turns out someone took the time to implement the socket code that also lets me pass in a URL here. And it will figure out how to do all the TCP stuff to go get the contents of the URL in question. So what was that URL? Well, it looks like it's quite simply this, which I just will copy from my browser, paste that in. I won't worry too much about the cleanliness here, just to get things going, because this is a bit of a long line. But let's save this here. OK, and now, ideally, what I have inside of my XML object is the contents of this RSS feed. And now it's actually pretty simple, right? If I now want to iterate over this data, assuming I haven't made any mistakes, let's go ahead and do this. I'm going to start an unordered list for now. And just to keep things somewhat pretty, I'm going to have a whole bunch of these list items where I want to have a link. So how do we do this? Well, we know we can do something like a for each. And now how can I get at what I want exactly? So for each XML, starting at the XML element, going down to channel, going down to item, was it? So as item, and now you can do, there are different ways to do this. I could use print statements or echo statements. I tend to like doing this when I can. So I'm going to open up this loop. So anything I put now where my blinking cursor here is going to be done iteratively within this loop. So on each iteration, what do I want to do? Well, first and foremost, I do want to have a list item. Have an A, H, and something, not quite sure yet. I'm going to have the title of the thing here, close the link, close the list item. So all it remains for me to do is to sort of fill in the proverbial blank. So I need the URL, and I need the title. Now, where are those going to come from? Well, let's take an arbitrary example. Here's an item element. It looks like title is in the child called title. And it looks like we have description, we have this. And actually, it looks like we have the link. The URL is embedded right in the feed. So it looks like I need title and link. So the easiest way to get at these is perhaps just to do echo item link and just inline that there. And then for title, echo item title. And anything I might have overlooked here? So do you have to start from RSS? If you're using an XPath query, yes. But if you're using the simple XML API, it actually assumes you mean start at the root element, because there can be, by definition, only one. So you can dive right into the first channel. It's actually, I think it's actually a little unclear, but such is how they do it. OK, any other comments before we try this out? Yeah?
If you chose to, could you specify RSS?
I don't know. Let's come back to that in a second. We'll try. Let's make sure it works, and then we'll answer that on the fly. I'm sorry? So escape special characters in the title. OK, we'll come back to that too. Let's see functionally if this thing's going to work. Hey, that's not bad. So we very simply, in, you know, dare say 5 minutes, which could have been whittled down to maybe 60 seconds if I'd kept my mouth shut, we could have just done this really quickly. incorporated some data, which is very nicely tagged, into my website. And now, this is clearly more than we're integrating into the website. So what we're actually doing in the website is also checking the date. Or actually, no, I think we've hard-coded in. Let's just show 6 at a time, because any more than that gets a little overwhelming. So instead of using a for each, what I think I did in our own index.php file was just use a for loop from I equals 0 to 6 or some constant value. And that's how we just keep the list a little clean. So that's it. And this, I think, speaks to, frankly, what's particularly compelling about a language like PHP is just how easy it makes it to do some very simple things without a lot of overhead and really without a lot of thought. Certainly, once you've done it before, you can apply it pretty easily. So just to summarize here, if you're interested in learning more about RSS from a technical angle, fortunately, there's really not that much to it, as its name sort of suggests. This is a URL at which the current spec for the 2.0 RSS 2.0 is maintained, so you can read up on what fields are supposed to be there and can be there, what all the various fields mean, but pretty much plucked off two of the juiciest ones. But frankly, I mean, this really is pretty simple. Just skimming this document, you can sort of infer that, it looks like I get a publication date out of each of these items. A GUID is meant to be a unique string which uniquely identifies that item. So in fact, as an aside, those of you who do use RSS readers and have the ability to delete messages that are in your thread, presumably your client figures out which of the items you no longer want to see anymore by just using this unique ID. And the convention tends to be to use a URL for the GUID because it sort of is by nature unique as opposed to choosing random integer instead. Description, and actually let's tease this apart for a second. It looks like description actually has what's in it called a C data section or a character data section. Anyone know exactly what this is all about? As in why C data there and this cryptic bracket, bracket, bracket on the end? Yeah. Exactly. Exactly. So in the world of XML, long story short, there's really two notions of data, PC data and C data. Parsed character data is everything that's pretty much between tags. C data is anything that's between tags, but more specifically between these very cryptic sequences, the idea of which is that no human is ever by accident or for his own reasons going to type something like this, hence we'll use it as an identifier. Anything between this symbol and this symbol here means that the parser, the XML parser, should not parse anything inside that string. It should just read it into memory verbatim until it reaches these end characters. And this is advantageous if, for instance, you want to have something silly like less than sign. Right? I mean, there's a few characters that should not appear in raw XML because they're just not allowed. It'll confuse a parser. But suppose that one of you in one of your posts used, well, is 2 less than 3? Question mark. Well, that simple description could actually screw up the entire file because it looks like the start of a tag, even though really it was a less than sign. So this is why the forum folks decided, just to avoid those issues, you know what, rather than encode this with HTML entities or something like that, let's just use a C data section so that it's not even parsed. And in fact, if we fast forward through this, yeah, so you see, forum does support some HTML code or uses some HTML code to create formatting effects. So this is just one big C data section. So it doesn't even have to be valid XHTML embedded in there. Just an FYI, things you'll encounter when using RSS. Any questions about such? And this is just meant to hint at the general framework, the general format for a typical RSS file. Now, all right, so let's take a look at one other, or reinforce one other interesting aspect of some PHP code here. This wireless connection seems to be a little flaky, so let me take us onto a wired connection here. So we're back. So this, just to give you a sense of some of the slightly more sophisticated things or syntactical things that you can do with this stuff, is our index.php file for the course's main page. And that's actually a bit of a white lie, because we're actually using Ajax on the course's page, so that if you just sit there twiddling your thumbs looking at the course's homepage, every minute it will actually update that list of most recent posts without you having to refresh it. But the interesting PHP code is in post.php, which we'll come back to in a few weeks in our JavaScript focus. But just to give you a sense of the flow here, and we can post this online as well, the very first thing we're doing is actually getting the time. Because what we wanted to do, in addition to showing some of the RSS posts on the course's homepage, is also have the announcements highlighted on the course's main page. But there's a lot of announcements that, you know, we don't tend to post frequent announcements, and it's really not all that compelling to, for instance, know for the next 3 weeks, just because it's in the RSS feed, that there were no section, or there was a section room change on February 21st. So what this suggests is that for some types of data, you know, you don't want to necessarily limit by 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 different items, but rather you do care about those pub dates, so to speak. And here too, one of the coolest functions that you'll see in PHP is one that we're using to implement this trick. So what are we doing here? So in our source code here, which unfortunately wraps because of the font size, we're first just getting the current time, Unix time in seconds since the epoch, January 1st, 1970, is stored in the now variable there. Now I'm just saying, all right, I just want to have an empty array called announcements here. I'm then doing an XML, simple XML elements using file get contents of the URL of our RSS feed. I just pasted it in there because I just wanted something quick and dirty when we whip this up. Now I seem to have syntax that's almost identical to what we just whipped up in our own demo, but the interesting thing seems to be happening here. So I'm saying if now minus 5 times 24 times 60 times 60, which if I cared about CPU cycles, I might have pre-commuted instead of leaving it like this, is less than this value, go ahead and add the item element to this array. Because really, my goal here is to only store in this announcements array a subset of the items from the RSS feed, only those that are the most current. So in English, what exactly is this line doing for me, perhaps? Yeah, so if it's been posted within the past 5 days, 5 times 24 hours times 60 minutes in an hour times 60 seconds in 1 hour, go ahead and add this to the array. But the neat function here, and again, speaking to the kitchen sink feature, is this thing. So pubdate, recall, actually does follow some format. So if we go back to that RSS feed, you'll note that it looked like, if we go back to the RSS feed, pubdate actually does follow a format, which if I really wanted to implement some tedium, I could go ahead and parse out the Monday, comma, then the date field, which is probably one or two characters, then the month, which appears to be 3 characters, and so forth. But fortunately, there's this function called stir to time, which quite frankly is one of the most wonderful inventions because it takes a fairly arbitrary date time format and just figures out what it is you mean. So it understands that particular format. It even understands things like plus 4 days if you want to get a Unix timestamp that's 4 days from whenever now is, something like that. So I would refer you to the documentation php.net for, but it's just wonderfully useful where you can pass it in fairly arbitrary date time format. It will figure out the equivalent Unix, return it as an integer, and then you can go ahead and use it and then proceed on your way. So there's one other thing that I wanted to do here though, because in the RSS feed, a lot of the titles actually look like this. A lot of the titles have, I'm lying slightly. A lot of the titles in the feed we're using look like this. Let me copy this, equals RSS. Let's just look at the course's homepage. So a lot of, by default, the feed of data that's coming through actually has the titles here, and then parenthetically the number of replies. Right? And just because I was a little anal when whipping this up and didn't really think it's that interesting to say parenthetically how many replies there were to an official announcement we made, I wanted to strip that off of the list item for the announcements. All right, so I have access to the title field, which for all of these items, at least in the RSS, I think I used a different RSS feed to implement this than the one you saw because we didn't see these parenthetical expressions, but I wanted to strip this out of an announcement, this out, anything that's between parentheses. So just based on past programming experience, what feature of this kind of language does that hint that we could deploy here to get rid of anything parenthetically at the end of a title? Yeah, so a regular expression. And you can imagine that the format here that the form is using, parenthesis, dot star for some number of characters, followed by close parenthesis, end of line, the end of the string. So if you haven't encountered these things just yet, particularly as you're trying to validate data for project one, realize that you can do things like this. Let me scroll down here. And here is the portion of code for the website where I now iterate over the 0 or more announcements that I have added to that array using the code earlier. What I want to do now is actually override the title with just a shorter version, thereby getting rid of the parenthetical expression. So it's in purple here that we see, quote unquote, this. So when we saw a bit of this last time, forward slash, some stuff, forward slash, in between which is the regular expression, though you can actually use different delimiters if you want. So it looks like I'm saying a little literal parenthesis, so backslash open paren, dot star, backslash close parenthesis, dollar sign. So the dollar sign, for those unfamiliar, just means match at the end of the string, not just anywhere in the middle potentially, but at the very end. And why do I escape the parentheses with the backslash? Yeah. Exactly. So in Perl regular expressions, or preg expressions, which PHP supports, parentheses do have special meaning. Because it's really useful with regular expressions if you want to not just match data and check if it fits some pattern, but you actually want to capture some of the data and actually return a subset of the string. So generally, parentheses will allow you to match something in a string and then return in a special variable just that substring. But if I literally mean parentheses here, I need to escape them like this. So this preg replace function in PHP is saying match this pattern, and if you do match it or find it somewhere in this string, go ahead and replace it with nothing, the empty string. In fact, just to prove that this is in fact live code, yes it is. Let's go back to the course's homepage. Oh damn. Yes, there it is. Okay. Yes it is. Little caching issue. So Thursday, February 21st, dot, 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 yes it is in fact appearing instead of those parentheses. But if I get rid of this line altogether, I'm not text, and in just a moment here, you'll see that it's in fact no replies, which is what form is doing by default. But we'll put it back there and leave it at that. And we'll tease apart some of the Ajax-y features of that in a couple of weeks. So any questions on RSS, regular expressions here, or just these general ideas? Yeah?
I don't know how greedy the matching algorithm is in this, but wouldn't that break things if the text of your announcement happened to have something parenthetical in it?
Ah, good question. So if the post's title ended with something parenthetical. Middle, no, because this, because how greedy the matching is. Good question. So I believe by default, so the question here is, this clearly matches an open parenthesis, followed by some stuff, followed by a closed parenthesis, end of string. But what if there's a left parenthesis in the title of the message itself that's then, therefore, to the left of form's own parenthetical expression? So I believe the default behavior for preg replace and these functions in Perl is to be as greedy as possible. I probably have to do a sanity check at home tonight and fix this and make the matching as non-greedy as possible, which I think in Perl, to add a question mark after the, well.
Just replace that dot with brackets, not close brackets.
Oh, I see. Okay, yes. So use a character class. Yep. So a better approach, and we can just fix this on the fly, is to say anything other than a left parenthesis star. Kind of like it the other way, just because it's
other than a
right parenthesis. Other than a. Well, let's see. Oh, but then this gets a little.
Start with a left parenthesis that has. Anything that's not a right parenthesis up to the right parenthesis at the end of the line.
Yes. Okay. Okay, let me. Yes, we're going to fix this during break so that I don't misspeak and I don't admit to coding on the fly. So what we want to do, yes, the goal is we have a left if we have a left parenthesis in the title somewhere, we want to make sure that we're matching the closest one to the close right parenthesis. Which is going to be, let's go back to this. OK, so go ahead and propose your solution then.
Left parenthesis.
Yep.
Left bracket.
Left bracket, yep.
Carrot.
Carrot.
Right parenthesis.
Right parenthesis.
Right bracket.
Right bracket. So you're saying match any, so match a left parenthesis followed by, so that captures that case.
At the end of the line.
But what I think still doesn't catch is if the if a student puts just a left parenthesis in their title without a right parenthesis for whatever reason, maybe with some reversed smiley, we're still going to be greedily matching too much of the string.
Okay, then put both the left and the right. So how about that MySQL?
How about that what? I'm sorry?
How about that MySQL?
Yes, okay, let's not get derailed here. I'll go back and think through all possible cases, though frankly, I think the best lecture demo makes for this one, right? It's very simple, but clearly a potential bug that I'm sure. All right, we'll wait for the wise guy to post a message tonight with a parenthesis, right? And that'll actually motivate me to fix this thing. Okay, so MySQL and SQL. So we spent the past couple lectures looking at XML, which certainly does have its advantages, not only for syndicating data like through RSS, but also in storing data, making it easy for the local pizza shop or even you, the sysadmin, writing a config file to update data without the overhead of a database, without the overhead of arcane SQL commands. But very quickly, can you outgrow that kind of sufficiency. And so an example that I thought we would use to drive tonight's introduction to SQL, and specifically MySQL, which is the database system you'll be using, of course, is a very real and, if not easily framed problem. Up until a few days ago, there was not this checkbox there and that description. And frankly, I was getting very annoyed having to log into my own website, my own course's website, every damn time I visited it. I'd much rather the website remember that I did just authenticate, you know, a day or so ago, an hour or so ago, so that even when I close my browser window, the site remembers that I'm logged in. And it's sort of a very simple, a very real-world problem that a lot of websites, for security reasons or maybe just other reasons, oversight, simply do not implement. So how can we do this? Well, we can do this in a number of ways, but what do you think is, I mean, just thinking aloud here, how could one go about doing this? And we'll ignore security for the moment. Let's just keep it simple. All right, so with a cookie. So a cookie is, again, a piece of data that a website can leave on your computer. And in fact, we've been using cookies anytime you've been using sessions thus far. But thus far, sessions use session cookies in the sense that as soon as you close your browser window, the session object that we've been talking about in the past few lectures disappears because your browser by default will no longer be sending back the unique identifier that associates that browser window with the session object on the server. And if you haven't come across it already, the name of the cookie that's actually being stored in RAM by default in PHP is a cookie called PHP sesh ID, which is just a really big pseudo random string of numbers and letters that your browser is sending back and forth. But it has a lifetime that is only as long as the browser window is open, which is unfortunately not helpful in this case because I want to be able to close my browser at night, shut down my computer even, and then still be logged in. So we can still use cookies, but we need to give these things a lifetime that's much longer than the life of the browser window. And you can absolutely do this using number of seconds from now that you want this cookie to persist. So what do we want to put in this cookie? Someone else. Sorry? Okay, so we can definitely put in the username. And in fact, in version 1.0 of the course website's login, it was at least doing that. Because I at least was also getting tired of constantly typing not only my password, but also my username, especially on my own computer, where it's pretty much just me logging into the course's website. And so for a while, we actually were storing a cookie for some number of days on each of your computers that did store in it your username, so that what would happen when you visit the website the next time? You wouldn't be logged in, but it would be pre-filled, that first username field. And that's arguably convenient, certainly, for users. Now it gets a little dicier with password. All right, so obviously, let's just continue Curtis's logic here and propose we store the password in a cookie. All right. You know, it's easy to sort of chuckle at this, but I'm sure it is done, especially by folks who don't quite understand what it means to be storing a cookie. Because when you store a cookie, you're actually storing that data on the user's computer, somewhere on their hard drive, in contrast to storing something in $_session, which is actually stored where? So it's actually stored on the server, and specifically by default, usually in /temp on a Linux box. So there's a file that's named almost identically to that pseudo random string I mentioned, the value of which is here. So that pseudo random string is stored on the user's computer, but the actual contents of $_ $_session is stored on the server in a text file, actually. So every time, in fact, that you're pulling up a website that's using $_session, the web server, assuming it doesn't do some kind of clever caching in memory, is actually opening that text file, reading it back into memory, and then creating the illusion to you all, the developers, that that object never actually went away, when in fact it was just tucked away on disk for a while. So storing the password on the cookie in the cookie is probably stupid, just to be clear here. For what reason? Yeah. Perfect. So just for clarity's sake today, lest you walk out wondering, oh, sure, that's stupid, but why? Because anyone that sits down at the computer subsequently, if they know enough about where Firefox or IE stores its cookies files, can just go double-click that file literally and voila, there's your password. And frankly, a fun at-home exercise might be to do a little string searches in maybe your cookies folder just to see if any websites, especially if you use some password on a lot of different sites, no judgments here, you can see if in fact it's tucked away somewhere in the cookies. So let's make a marginal improvement on this what would be a marginal improvement on this? And don't shout out SQL or something like that. Yeah. Okay, we could generate a random string and then do what? Okay, so generate a random string, store that in the cookie, but where's the why?
We generate the random string using the password and something else.
Okay, so generate the random string using the password and something else toward what end? Just finish the story here. Okay. Okay, interesting. So really obfuscate the password, but in a reversible fashion. So don't take a one-way hash of it, so to speak, but rather, you know, use ROT13, for those of you who are familiar, and store that on the computer just to simplify things and send the encrypted version, so to speak, back to the server. And actually, maybe we can just summarize it as that. Just encrypt the password, tuck it away in the browser's cookie, so that the ciphertext comes back to the server, and so long as your key on the server is not compromised, you can presumably decrypt the password and then go ahead and authenticate the user. Yays, nays? It's pretty simple.
Could you make an authentication variable so and put that in the
cookie? Okay, so we could have this is good. Let's come back to this in just a moment and just finish this thread for a second, because interesting questions as well. So if we just store an encrypted version of the password in the cookie, it's better, certainly. Best? Yeah. Well, so anyone who sits down at the computer could certainly still sign in, but that's sort of the price you pay for checking that box anyway. So that's sort of a given. But where is the potential security threat here?
You take that cookie and you could scrape the cookie.
So you could scrape the cookie, you now have the ciphertext, and you can just use a dictionary attack, a brute force attack. If you've got some spare time, or just download one of these free cracking utilities, assuming you know what cipher at least was used, and odds are if you know the site's driven by PHP, it's probably the crypt function, or whatever comes for free with PHP, you can just do a brute force algorithm on it. And odds are that would work on a lot of people's passwords, so you would just need physical access to get at that cookie, or some browser bug that exposes the cookie. So not bad, but it's generally not good practice to just give access to users to your passwords, or your password files, even if they're encrypted. In fact, for years, early on, /etc/password contained username :ciphertext, among other things for users' usernames and passwords. Most folks have moved to other systems, even just shadow passwords, whereby /etc/password is no longer chmodded 644, but 600, and there's no longer even passwords in there, just because best to give the user as little data as possible. So not bad, and certainly a good improvement, but not perfect. Now let's revisit this issue here instead. Maybe we should just move away from storing username and password at all, but store some kind of number like true, a value of true in a cookie that just signifies to the server when that cookie is resent to it, and this user has already authenticated before, because the cookie called authenticated is equal to 1, therefore I should let this user pass. So not a bad idea. It's a very different approach, but there's a huge gotcha here, at least with that implementation.
Can I craft my own cookie to
Yeah, so that's the catch, right? Just as you can read these cookies, so can I open them up with Notepad and just type authenticated equals true or the equivalent. So there too, it breaks down if you're using something so deterministic and so simplistic to actually implement this. Yeah?
Is the fundamental problem that you're using your losing your PHP sesh ID cookie because it's a session cookie?
So effectively, yes. So in a nutshell, it would be nice if a session object by default only lives for as long as the browser is. So let's maybe just fix that.
Either make PHP not tell the browser to dump it at the end of the session, or copy the value into something from multiple dump and then copy it back into PHP.
Good. So one approach would be, why don't we just extend the lifetime of this cookie called PHP sesh ID, which isn't the value 1, which is too simple and too easily spoofed, but is actually a fairly long pseudo random string that is that maps to some data stored in a temporary file on the server. So this too could actually be feasible. There's some back-end gotchas here where by default, if cookies tend to be stored in /temp, that directory tends to be cleared out a lot. Then you actually have a lot of user data sitting on your file system where you might not want it for various reasons because it can become stale. Right? If you really are just trying to remember that the user is logged in, you don't want to conflate that goal with storing, say, the username and other, the contents of their shopping cart, if maybe that might change if they go to some other computer. So maybe workable, but there's some issues for sort of hijacking the principle of this particular cookie, but certainly not a bad idea. But to be clear, what's enticing about the fact that that cookie's value is actually a pretty long pseudo-random string? I'll be really the computer scientist, can be spoofed with very low probability, right? Because if it's a string that's maybe 24 or 48 characters, alphanumeric, capital and lowercase, absolutely someone could spoof that cookie. In fact, today, if you were logging into a fairly common website that uses cookie-based authentication and sessions, absolutely, if you had enough time, you could just start guessing PHP sesh IDs, just use a simple Firefox plugin, and just manually specify what cookies you want to be sending to the server. And frankly, all of you are programmers. You could just write code that would just pretend, a la the could just pretend to send some HTTP headers after connecting to the server, and then send the cookie header string that actually contains a guessed string. Now, it might take you some number of days, years, millennia to guess that session ID, but that's the fundamental risk here, right? Any of these websites that are allowing you to remember that you're logged in, you are exposing yourself to at least a couple of threats. One is the physical access one. Someone sits down at your computer, they're into your Bank of America account or whatever it is you've saved your password for. Or more sort of fundamentally present is this risk that someone could just guess your cookie value. Now, there are ways to push back on that. Let's just push back on this before we turn to some actual code, because it's actually kind of an interesting thing. What would a smart server-side webmaster do if you were actually worried about that threat, someone spoofing cookie values? So you could certainly change the cookie value over time so that you narrow the amount of time that they have to wage their brute force attack. What else could you do just to do a bit of a sanity check that this cookie came from the original user? Sure, absolutely. You could just say, after trying to guess if this IP address is trying to log in, for instance, 12 times in a row, 100 times in a row, that's probably not a human. That's a program. So we could filter them out that way. So the Mac code, tougher to do with this kind of language. But in theory, if we had some kind of unique identifier, we could just do interesting things by encrypting the user's IP address and tucking that in the cookie so that we can sort of reverse it and just do some sanity checks. So long story short, there are threats here. There are also some possible solutions. Fortunately, at least from an application developer's perspective, a lot of those details can sort of be entrusted to the server. And among the things PHP, I believe, will do, actually with cookies, you can't rely on IP address at all. Sort of case in point. It'd be really annoying if every time I just take my laptop somewhere, I have to re-log into the website just because my IP has changed. So again, there's some trade-offs here. But let's actually start to think about this with some actual code. So among your handouts tonight is a packet of 9 examples, which I wrote to be as well commented as possible, because we'll go from version 1 to version 9, which does in fact incorporate, among others, a SQL database, to see how we can tackle a problem like this, and then along the way tell some tales that make this representative of some problems in general. So with that said, let me go into the directory for which you have a printout and take a look at the following. So in the lectures 3 source, we have this login directory, and here is our goal. So I whipped up a very simple web page. It is actually XHTML, but it's quite ugly. But it does check if I'm logged in or not. And the goal here, quite simply, is to begin implementing a framework for any website that checks first, before displaying any content, is the user logged in? And if so, maybe show them one set of data. And if not, show them another set. Or just don't show them certain information at all. And we'll see on Project 2, when you incorporate exactly this principle into Project 2 for an authentication mechanism, that the best way of doing this isn't necessarily so obvious. And I make no claim that any of our examples, 1 to 9, is the best. Better for you to sort of tease that apart, perhaps, on Project 2. So this is a very simple page here. How can I go about checking, conceptually, if a user is logged into my website? Well, let's think about how we might have gotten here. So suppose I was on the courses website, and I was at this page here, and I have logged in. Because think back now to lecture 0 or 1, when we first looked at this login idea. When I type in a correct username and a correct password, not only is the server going to check, is username equal to what it should be, password equal to what it should be, what was our login.php code doing last time? To remember the fact that David did in fact just log in, so I'm not constantly presented with this screen anytime I try to access a protected resource. Yeah, so I was storing a session variable. And in the courses website, what was I tucking specifically into the session object? Sorry? Yeah, so I was just tucking in the username. And I, because I designed the whole website, was just inferring if I ever found that the username key was set in the session object, the implication, because of how I've architected the site, is that this user has logged in before. But if that variable, $_session, quote-unquote username, is null, that is, it's not set, the implication is the user is not logged in. Otherwise, I, myself, would have put a value in that variable. So I can just check it. And this is a very common way of just checking for authentication. So now, though, I want to do this same idea so that when I'm on this homepage, I want some more interesting stuff to show up there. Where it says you are not logged in, I want it to tell me when I am logged in. And then in theory, a more complicated website actually be my bank account information or something that's actually contingent on my being logged in. So how can we approach this? So you can kind of imagine how you might implement the form with some simple HTML. We've got two fields, username and password. I at least have made the password field obfuscated with these bullets. We're going to ignore issues of SSL and such for these demos and run it on HTTP here. So it's not actually encrypted, but it's really the underlying code that's interesting. So how might we go about doing this? Well, one approach might be this. So this is your login1.php file. And it's pretty simple. In fact, most of the file is just some XHTML to display that form. And the logic, the controller logic, so to speak, is at the very end of the file. So the very first thing I'm doing is calling session start. And what is that doing exactly? It is starting sessions. So it is effectively defining the session object to be accessible to me. But more importantly, it's doing what? Yes. Yeah. So this might explain. We've seen a bit of discussion of this on the bulletin board. Any of you who have seen that message that said, seen an error message related to session start because headers have already been sent? The reason is that what session start is doing, among other things, is sending a cookie colon header that contains the PHP sesh ID that this user has been assigned and that pseudo random string. But that must be included among the web page's very first lines of output so that it's actually in those HTTP header lines and not in the body of the web transaction. And the only thing that distinguishes an HTTP set of headers versus the actual content of the page or content being delivered is a new line. A blank line is all that delimits the HTTP headers from everything else. So if you accidentally, and it's actually an annoying feature so to speak, of PHP. If you, for instance, have something like this at the top of your file, which looks pretty reasonable, right? We all have white space at the top files. What that will typically do for what the web server will typically do is output new line, new line, new line. Then down here, session start is called. So then gets outputted cookie colon dot, dot, dot. But it's too late. By that point, the headers have already been sent. And session start is PHP is detecting as much. And that's why you get that warning. So common troubleshooting is to make sure that nowhere are you actually outputting even blank lines atop these files. And also, if you're calling a line of code that generates a notice or a warning that maybe you're not seeing because it's not being outputted in the body of the web page, if you have a warning colon message that happens to be spit out before session start is actually called, similarly, can you experience that as well? So it usually hints at a problem with like white space or some other error because session start is realizing, ah, the HTTP headers have already all been sent because some other content was sent as well. Yes, yes. So it's a very annoyingly recursively defined problem. So if you're including or requiring other files and one of those has white space even at the end of it, because if you're including a file that has white space at the end of it, require and include pretty much just open the file, copy the contents, and paste it in, like a C header file. There, too, are you going to get content white space, unfortunately, before the within your HTTP headers. So a bit of a nuisance. And you can sort of fix this in other ways, but really just vigilance is the solution to this problem. So how can we go about the notion of login? So because I want to remember that the user has been logged in. I didn't really want to bother with an XML file for a lecture demo. So henceforth, the username tonight will be J Harvard, and the password will be Crimson. And I'm defining these in two variables called all caps, user, and pass. So very simply, much like I did with that login example a week or two ago, I'm checking if the user field in post and the pass field in post are both set. The implication is what, to be clear? That a form was submitted to this file as opposed to the user just pulling up the URL. And this allows me to embed both the form itself and the controller logic that logs the user in the same file, which keeps things a little clean and lets me pre-populate the form much more easily, as some of you have seen with some of the section examples. So if something was submitted and the user field equals user and pass equals pass, therefore we have a match, let's go ahead and log the user in. I took an even simpler approach here. I'm not even going to bother remembering the username. I'm just going to set a Boolean flag called arbitrarily authenticated and tuck in the value true to the session so that I can just check a bit. Is the user authenticated or not? I'm going to redirect the user. And unfortunately, you have to jump through some hoops because even though, again, you often see location colon filename.php for a redirect, which works on every browser I've ever seen, it's technically not correct. At least in HTTP 1.1, you need to send the whole URL that you want to redirect the user to. And here's some lines of code borrowed from the PHP manual that just make that pretty easy to do. Won't work in all cases. Obviously, I'm hard coding HTTP, but it gets the job done for our demo. But take a look at that URL if you're curious. So down here, it's just the form. Notice I'm not doing any pre-population. There's no value attribute on any of these tags. But let's see what the effect is. J Harvard, Crimson, login. Voila. I seem now to be logged in. Now, what if, though, I go back to the login page and then, oh, wait a minute. You know what? Let me go back to home.php. Oops, what was it called? Oh, wrong directory. Let me go back to home.php. And fortunately, I'm still logged in. I haven't closed the browser window. So even if there were links that I could hop around on, even if I typed in a bunch of URLs, went over to some other website like Facebook, then came back to this site within the same browser window, the cookie should persist. Because IE or Firefox should be remembering that I have PHP sesh ID tucked somewhere away in my browser. But in my browser's RAM, not on disk for the sesh ID. All right. How can we do better? What is a feature that's missing from this login version 1? I can sort of shout out the obvious here. What's it not doing, even though I just logged in and logged out? It's not saving my username. All right. So, and moreover, suppose I make a typo here. Suppose I do type in J Harvard, but I just type some junk for the password by accident. That too gets a little annoying when websites don't so much as remember that. So just to, you know, let's do a marginal improvement before getting to some really juicy stuff. How do we fix this? What needs to be changed? Quite simply, arguably, in this file. Yeah, so. Okay, so post, and I think it's user, yeah? So just like this? Okay, good. So I actually need this to be actual PHP code. And common mistake that's come up a couple times, I think, on the bulletin board. Yes, okay? So even I do this all too often. You need to actually print this value or echo the value out. Now, technically, just as an FYI, there's whole different levels of error reporting in PHP. There's a notice level, an error level, a warning level, and you can turn on and off the different reporting mechanisms by this error reporting function that I think we saw in lecture one or so. The reason I mention this is because you will, I believe, get a notice, a sort of mini warning from PHP if you try to use a variable that just hasn't been defined. So I bring this up because if I just pull up this URL without submitting a form, technically the code is trying to echo a variable that doesn't exist because post is not defined when you just pull up a URL. Typically, most websites don't run with notice level warnings enabled because there's just many of them. And that, frankly, there's a lot of syntactic tricks like this where I could fix this by saying if is set post username, then echo that, or sorry, user. But there comes a point here where now I'm just writing twice as much code just to avoid notices. So it's a trade-off, and this is more correct. But just realize that depending on your server and what notice levels you have set on, you could trigger warnings with something like that. But quite common is to just do something like this because it's so darn easy. All right, so will this do the trick? Let's go ahead and save it. Let's go ahead and try logging in as Jay Harvard with a bogus password, and excellent. Right, in about lecture 10 or so of this course, we'll learn how to move the cursor by default to this field so it's blinking. But we're not ready for that yet. At least it's irrelevant to PHP, at least. So what else is missing from this example? What else can we do? Okay, so we could certainly be telling the user that the password was incorrect here. And how might we go about doing this? And instantly log in 2.php for reference. The idea that we just did, this pre-population of the username field for your reference. All right, so what if we wanted to tell the user, you know what, you actually didn't type something correct, rather than just return them to this form like we're doing now. If I log in with the wrong password, I'm not even getting any useful feedback. So there's different ways of doing this, certainly. But at what point in the story might it be nice to inform the user of this? You know, it's typically done maybe right above the form so that there's actually some mention of it. And again, without regard for aesthetics tonight, just functionality, one of the things I could do is something like, I could do something like if count post is greater than 0, thereby signifying that there was something submitted to this site. Well, what do I want to do? If I'm at this point in the story and post has been defined with one or more variables, really, I want to say invalid password. And actually, let me do something like that. Invalid. Yeah, about that. Invalid login. Two birds with one stone. So now let's do this again. Let me go back to the URL. Let's log in with Jay Harvard and a bunch of stuff. Okay, so now at least we have something. It's not pretty, but at least that's an idea. And again, we could spend all day thinking about where we could put this logic, how we could detect as much, but really it's just the basic idea that we'll focus on for now so that we can build up to the actual remembering via cookies of something more than this. Okay, so what else might we do? Well, in this version, login 3.php, it would be really nice if not only did we pre-populate the field for username when the user makes a mistake and just doesn't log in correctly. But it'd be really nice once I close my browser window if the site remembered that I was just there recently and filled in the username field. So it's not quite the checkbox that remembers username and password or equivalent, but it at least remembers my username. So what, based on our earlier discussion, is the clear-cut solution to that? What do I need to do? Yeah, so I now actually need to store not just a session cookie, so to speak, like this, which goes away when the browser closes. I actually need to write something to the user's hard drive. And to do that, you need to send an actual cookie whose lifetime is longer than the browser window. And as you noted, the function in PHP to do this is, nicely enough, called setCookie. So how can we do this? Well, in login3.php, we pretty much have the exact same code, because even as I was whipping up these demos, just took one version, renamed it plus one, and just started adding some new features to it. We pretty much have the same code, but there's one new line right here in the middle. So the setCookie function in PHP takes a few parameters, some of which are optional, the first one of which is just the name of the cookie. So there's an example name. I don't recommend using that because you'll create all sorts of problems. But user is a very reasonable cookie name to use. The cookies are stored on a per site basis, so you don't have to worry about clobbering some other website's cookie. So I'm going to call this user. The value I'm going to store in the user's hard drive is just going to be their user name, which at this point has already been validated because I'm inside the branch that already said if the username and password are correct, do the following. So I'm going to set the cookie called user, give it a value of whatever was submitted, and now I'm going to do this trick, which based on our math earlier is saying store this cookie on the hard drive for how long? So for 7 days. So from now. So assuming my clock is correct, assuming the user's browser is correct, this will say to the browser, keep this thing around for 7 days from this moment in time. So clearly there's a potential worry here, maybe security even, if you're trusting the data that's coming from the user's computer. Because if they just manually override the lifetime of their cookie, unless you're doing some server-side validation with related to this stuff, someone could log in 8 days hence, if at least you're not doing some sanity checks on the server. So just realize that you don't have any control over this data once it's been sent to the user. And it's up to you to think about the security considerations, which we'll discuss over time. But syntactically, that's all it takes. And let's see how this might work now. So just so that we start with a clean slate, I'm going to go ahead to IE's delete browsing history, delete all, so that it gets rid of any cookies that I have from our website already or the demos we've been doing. I'm going to pull up login3.php and log in as jharvard and with the correct password crimson. But before I submit and actually let this cookie get created, I'm going to find my cookies, which on IE are under browsing history settings, view files, I believe. So I think it's going to end up in here, in temporary internet files for IE7. So let's go ahead and log in now to the website. OK, I'm logged in. And now let's copy this URL so I can get back to it quickly. Close the browser altogether. Go back over here and pull up the same demo. OK, I'm not logged in, but that wasn't quite the goal. What's going on? Log in. Yeah, that's correct. Let's try this again. OK, go back to login3.php. Oh, weird. OK, weird. Maybe that was it. OK, so weird. We'll write that off as a browser weirdness. Because it does work, right? Tested it before. It works now. So this will work 50% of the time, apparently, this trick. So what has actually happened? Well, notice I haven't submitted anything this time. All I did was pull up this URL. And not to tempt fate here, but let me do it a third time, improve our success rate. OK, good. So it is pre-populating. If I look at the XHTML, we should see something that's pretty much as expected. There is, in fact, a value field here. And hard-coded in there now is jharvard. Where did that come from? Well, let's just scroll back to the file for a second, because down here is the XHTML. I'll reveal in a second how it is we're outputting that cookie value. But more interesting first is the fact that in my temporary internet files is, in fact, some text file. What it's named is really going to vary by browser version and browser type. But it does appear just to be a text file. Let me open a text editor and open this text file. And here is what Microsoft has decided a persistent cookie will look like on disk. It looks like we have the name of the cookie, followed by the value, followed by a path. So actually, I didn't use this yet, but you can actually specify the relative path for which this cookie is valid. So in fact, this cookie should, for my browser, only be sent when I am pulling up a web page somewhere within that subdirectory, called login. So if I go to another subdirectory or the root of our website, that cookie should not be sent. And therefore, it should not appear in the cookie object, as we'll see in just a moment. But then 1024 is referring to something. Those things look like timestamps of some sort. So there's also some other numbers that are getting stored in there, some of which I have control over, some of which I might not have control. But let's see actually how it is I'm outputting J Harvard to this web page. Well, scrolling down, notice that I'm actually now doing something a little more clever than before. And I'll add some new lines here just to make it clear. Okay, so notice now I'm doing this little trick. So I'm echoing parentheses, question mark, something, colon, something. Now what that does, we'll reveal in 5 minutes. All right, we are back. Now hopefully this syntax is old hat to most of you. But what we have here to echo out the username in that topmost username field is just the equivalent of an if else statement. But using this nice fancy one-line syntax, where really what I'm saying is if the username key is defined in post, go ahead and output the username field in post, else output the value in this cookie object. So that's really the interesting takeaway here, that beyond get and beyond post, beyond request and beyond session, and a few of those other all caps super global variables we've talked about, PHP for free gives you this other one, $_cookie. Which contains, as an associative array, any of the key value pairs that was sent from the browser to the server as cookies via that cookie colon HTTP header. So what this is saying really is that in this one line of code, I'm able to handle two cases. One, I'm pre-populating this field with J Harvard if the user just typed in a wrong password. But if they just pulled up this page and didn't actually submit anything, else, I'm going to just check the user field in the cookie value and see what is actually there and output that. And if there's no cookie, well, that's fine. It's just going to be value equals quote unquote, no actual value. And I'll just try a trick here. I don't know if IE has any kinds of restrictions on allowing us to do this, but it could be an interesting demo if it actually works. So let's go over to login4.php. Still looks the same. And actually, we have, let's see, is it 4 we want or? Login name, password, and cookie. Which one's this? This is login 4. Let's go back to 3. So login 3.php is, in fact, setting the cookie. So let's go to that version here, J Harvard. Now let me go ahead and type in, let's go over to that cookie. So just to play games with the site, and again, I don't know if this is going to work, but let's change the J Harvard to J Hacker. Okay, we'll save it. And assuming IE is not doing any kind of hashing to validate this data, let me go back to the web page, reload. Let's try reloading more thoroughly. Okay, so it seems to be doing something else beyond just checking this cookie value. Interesting. Okay, so it's doing something else, which is good, because otherwise it would be really easy for you to do this. So maybe IE6 wasn't as smart, but we won't dwell on that detail. All right, so good. The point, though, pedagogically, is that had we been able to change that, that sort of speaks to the ease with which someone can mimic this. And frankly, that's just an IE protection. I could still go ahead and whip up some code that just sends the HTTP header and sends the cookie colon field, and I could, in fact, spoof that stuff very easily if I can't rely, obviously, on IE7 to do it. All right, so now let's take a look at login4.php. So login 4 actually does look a little different already. I decided by version 4, you know, it was time to take things up a notch and actually now keep the user logged in until they explicitly click logout, even if they close that browser window. So I want some cookie now to persist, not just for the username, but also I want to remember that the user was logged in. So you know what? Version 4 of this at this point, for the first round of implementation for this feature, I just wanted to keep it simple. And you know what I ended up deciding to do? All right, call it stupid, but it was really easy to copy a line of code that I'd already written, paste it in, and just change one value in it. So now I'm obviously storing not only the user field, but also for 7 days, the password field. So let's see what happens now with this cookie. Let me go ahead and flush my cache, delete all cookies with IE, close the browser window so we don't see that same symptom again, hopefully. Go back to the website, login 4. Why is it doing that? Let's try that again. Let's do it once more. Close the browser. Open the browser. I thought so. User pass. Oh, that could be interesting. Preventing it from getting deleted as a lock. All right, let's try this a third time. All right, close it. Open it.
What is the password leading for that form that you pull up? It says it's deleting passwords. That's not deleting. Yeah, that's delete code.
No, but I've been clicking delete all, which should be deleting everything. All right, so you know what we do in these cases? Really good lessons we're teaching tonight. Oh, look, now it's blank. All right. So what's going to happen next? I'm going to log in as Jay Harvard with Crimson. But this time, I'm going to check this box. Because according to the logic here, if the post variable called keep is set, you know, something non-null, then I'm also going to send this cookie here. So set pass equal to this value, which is just whatever the user typed in. And notice that the checkbox I defined down here with an input field is called keep. So really just a couple lines of code, a little XHTML, a little PHP, and I'm now able to set a cookie that includes the user's password, if that's the case. So let's go ahead and click login. Not now. OK, I'm logged in. Now let's try this again. So let's go back to version 4, or rather, we'll just keep this code here. Home, I'm logged in. And now if Firefox behaves correctly, what I should see when I go back here now, oh my god. What's going on? All right. Login4.php. Set the cookie. If set, if user pass. Yeah, that's right. Let's try this again. It's stupid browser caching. Okay. So unfortunately, we're learning some annoying lessons here, at least for I'm learning some annoying lecture. How do you fix this? OK, so there's a number of hacks that if you look up online, there's unfortunately no good, simple way to really discourage 100% reliably browser caching. So if you look up on PHPNet and a bunch of other places, you'll actually see a number of hacks, solutions that involve sending a pragma header, a no cache header, and a couple of other things as well, which we actually do on the course's website to ensure that everything is fresh and never stale. Unfortunately, I didn't include that for these lecture demos, not thinking we needed all this complexity, but these are the stupid issues that we're encountering. For instance, there, the browser was caching it. So my apologies for the lack of clarity there. But the interesting takeaway for us now is the following. If I go over to login4.php, all right, let's do this. Login4.php, login4.php. OK, so we have this. Let's go ahead and Jay Harvard, Crimson, keep me logged in. Don't remember this password, because that's a browser thing and not a cookie thing. Now let me go ahead and go up to Options here, Privacy, and under Cookies, Show Cookies. And what Firefox does, even though presumably it's storing it somewhere on disk, I'm not sure where the path is, but they present us with this nice GUI that shows us with this little window what the cookies are that have been sent. So if I expand this field here, notice that there are three cookies that Firefox is currently retaining for this site. Well, let's go ahead and look at PHP sesh ID first, because that one's created any time you call session start. And what's nice about Firefox is rather than just opening it with like text pad, which I did for IE, it actually parses the fields out and tells you what they mean. So here's the content. So I promised earlier it's this long pseudo-random string. That's it. So you could forge this, but probabilistically not so likely. This is the host for which this is valid. So that's how Firefox knows to send this for our website as opposed to, say, Facebook.com. The path for which this cookie is valid. So by default, sessions work anywhere on the site. So they're relative to the base URL. Send for any type of connection via some of those optional parameters, set cookie, that function. You can actually say, is this good for just HTTP or HTTPS connections? So that's what that is hinting at. And then when does it expire? So by default, a cookie, if you don't specify the expiry, will expire at the end of the browser session. So that's what that's denoting there. But that's it. That's all that maintains state effectively with an otherwise stateless.
Send for comes into play when you try to retrieve a cookie.
So what comes into play?
Send for. So if it says send for only a secure connection and I'm on a regular HTTP connection, then I get nothing back if I ask.
I believe so. The browser should not send that same cookie. But again, it's not necessarily safe to trust the browser. It's really just a convenience thing, if anything. So now let's tease apart some of the more interesting ones that I explicitly sent. So here's that username field. So it looks like the user field, it's called user, contents jharvard. So that matches what was in IE's file for this host. This path, because I didn't specify a path explicitly, any type of connection. But here's when it expires. So it looks like it expires, you know, pretty much 7 days hence, on this day at that time. So that's pretty neat. In fact, it does seem to be sent. Unfortunately, with this login for.php, so was the password sent. All right, now we could jump through hoops and try some of these other solutions like hashing it, encrypting it on the browser side, but we probably want a more robust, a more appropriate solution to this problem. So how can we implement then the equivalent of this checkbox so that the user can actually, oh good, that's to be expected, actually check that box, stay logged in, but without this inherent security risk. Now there'll still be a security risk, but at least not this same one. Yeah? Oh, what an excellent segue to our focus on SQL here, which login5.php actually does. So how can we go about solving this problem? Well, ideal would be to retain state, more of the state on the server side. And it isn't sufficient, obviously, just to store a value like authenticated equals one on the cookie side, on the browser side, because then anyone can just create that cookie manually or forge the headers and send that cookie and convince that they are, in fact, authenticated when they're not. So maybe the solution here is really to borrow the same spirit of session maintenance, right? Maybe we don't want to hijack session and have this persist because that really starts to mess with what Apache and PHP are trying to do out of the box. But maybe we can borrow the spirit of that idea where we use a really long pseudo-random string, but rather than leave it to Apache and PHP to remember the state, we're going to build this memory into our own application for remembering that checkbox and maybe some other features like what's in your shopping cart. It's really nice with Amazon where if you start adding things to your shopping cart, don't check out. No, maybe even shut down and return the next day. So long as you were logged into the site when you added things to your cart, you didn't maintain that state. Not necessarily with the same approach, but there's clearly compelling reasons for doing this. So how can we go about doing this? Well, it sounds like we need to send a cookie to the user's browser that has a really long pseudo-random string. But then what would we want to do on the server side, perhaps?
Take a record that uses that long pseudo-random string and associate state.
Perfect. So we really just want to now remember that that pseudo-random string belongs to that username. And maybe in simplest form, that is enough to remind us that, hey, you know what? Because we have some database that says jharvard's pseudo-random string is 12345678 9, that means, because our database says as much, that jharvard should be allowed to pass through without being prompted for his username and password again. And we can do yet more validation if we really want, but that seems at least to be much better than any of the solutions thus far. Certainly better from remembering all the state only on the user's browser. It's still hard to forge, not impossible, but certainly much harder. So let's turn our attention now to login5.php. So finally, are we doing away with those hard-coded constants and pulling up something known as a database? So most of you here, having had prior programming experience or doing this stuff full time, have some familiarity with databases, whether it's Microsoft Access or Oracle or even MySQL. One of the simplest ways to introduce the notion, though, of a MySQL database, or really databases in general, is just a table. So if you've never programmed against databases, you'll know at the end of tonight, at least the basic building blocks. And we'll do more sophisticated things with SQL next week. But if you've ever used Microsoft Excel, you know that Excel gives you access to columns and rows. Now that really is what a relational database, like MySQL or Oracle or MS Access, provide you with is any number of tables that look like this that you can define columns for. Like this might be the username column. This might be the password column. This might be the phone number column. And then each row represents, say, a username in your database table. So the first thing I'm going to do then is create using MySQL, which is just a very popular open source database system that's increasingly popular because of its performance and its price tag. I'm going to define just one table right now that just stores a username and the pseudo random string so that I'm remembering on the server that if Jay Harvard sends this same token, so to speak, the next time he visits and that username token match what I think it should be in my database, that means he's logged in. Because the odds of Jay Harvard having guessed, or someone other than Jay Harvard having guessed that J Harvard's pseudo random string is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, for instance, is just so low that that's sufficient for our security concerns. All right, so how can we do this? Well, back in the day, and certainly still now, the means by which you interacted with MySQL was with a favorite old command line prompt. And you can absolutely still do this, but it's arguably not the nicest way to interact with one's database, even though all of the commands we'll start looking at, all of the queries we'll start looking at tonight and next week, can be executed right at a command line that looks as simple as this. Unfortunately, with more complicated commands, like creating tables, moving data around, it becomes increasingly cumbersome to type fairly long SQL commands all at just a command line prompt. And so what we'll actually preach in the course and use for both pedagogical and convenience reasons is something called PHP MyAdmin, which is a very popular software product, freely available, that is just a GUI front end MySQL and allows us to create, delete, modify tables, search tables with a web-based interface after logging into it with our database's username and password. So this is just a much easier way of sort of learning some of the features of SQL and specifically MySQL without having to type more, without having to rely only on arcane commands at the command line. And it's pedagogically compelling because, too, you'll often get drop-downs, frankly, of the possible options for the possible data types that are appropriate, the certain attributes that you can apply to fields, and it sort of just teaches you as you go what you can do with these database tables, which is really quite nice. So let's go about doing this. We have on cs75.net a MySQL database running. If you install XAMPP on your own computers, that package comes with MySQL too, so you can run it on your own box as well. And this PHP MyAdmin installation is at cs75.net/phpMyAdmin. And actually, let me take one step back and actually go to panel.cs75.net first. Because if you haven't noticed, what you can use, what you can do with your logins is you'll see that you have some number of databases allocated to you, at least 6 for the course's purposes, one for each project, and then a couple of extras, one or two extras in case you want to play around. I'm going to click MySQL Management after logging in. And now what I did before class, quite simply, was click Create New Database. And I created a new database name, a new database user, and I gave myself a password. And all that does is create an empty database. It's like creating a new Excel document with nothing in it, not even a work sheet. All right, and that database table that I already created was called Malin Test. And what I'm going to do is type in, I'm going to change my password here for a moment because I don't remember what it was. And we're going to say it's this. So for the next 30 minutes, all of you can hack into my database, but that's okay because my password is password. All right. So what do I need to do? Well, what's really nice about PHP is that among the kitchen sinks are really nice integration with MySQL. And out of the box, you get built-in support for MySQL and actually a couple of other database management systems. And the documentation comes replete with examples, which is nice. But the first two steps that we need to do are quite simply this. We need to connect to the server, and then we need to select a specific database. But then henceforth, executing a SQL command via PHP is as relatively as simple as we'll see as calling this function, MySQL query. Because what's in parens is just the select star from foo, or the SQL commands that you might know already or will soon know for the course. So let me fill in some blanks here. I'm going to connect to localhost. The username is MalinTest, and the password is password. Actually, the username is mail and test, password is password, and just for simplicity or confusion's sake, the database is also called mail and test, and I left that in from before. So in fact, in your printouts, it has mail and test, but really I meant to blank it out, just FYI. So now there's two commands here. One, I'm calling MySQL connect with those credentials, and ideally it's going to return a reference to an object that presents it. Then I'm going to say, because as you will soon see, you can have multiple databases on one server, we need to select a specific database, for instance my Project 1 database or my mail and test database. And if that just doesn't work, if you haven't encountered this before, the die function in PHP, like in Perl, is almost equivalent to calling exit with an informative error message. Not great for production code, since it will just print a very simple white screen with an error message, but certainly for demo purposes, it gets the job done and implements some error handling. A real website would want to present the user with maybe less technical information, but prettier information. And now the rest of the code is fairly similar in structure. So if a username and password were submitted, let's go ahead and do the following. I want to create a SQL string. So there are a bunch of ways that you can interact with a database, a relational database like MySQL. You can select information, that is, read information from it. You can insert, that is, write information to it. You can delete information from it, and a few other basic constructs. So the basic syntax for a select statement is to say select the field names, or if you want all of them, star, from the name of the table that you want the data from, where zero or more properties are true. Now this is out of context because I sort of know where we're going, but recall that we have to actually do something with this database, or rather we need to create a table if we have in fact started with a blank slate. So I'm going to log into PHP MyAdmin with those credentials. And you'll see a screen similar to the screenshot we saw a moment ago. Up here at top left are two tables. And let's see, I am going to go ahead here and take the very drastic approach of, do we want to delete those? Yes, we'll be drastic. What do we want to do? Drop table tokens, drop table users. About to delete all of last night's hard work. Okay, all gone. Unfortunately, we have nothing in this database now. So this is the equivalent of having opened up a blank document. So I want to create a new database table on mail and test. And all I did was click the database's name. So what do we want to call this thing? Well, the first goal at hand actually isn't going to even be to implement that checkbox, because if I got rid of my username and password constants and actually am now storing all my user data in my database, well, let's at least start ourselves off with the users table. And let's keep things simple. How many columns do we want to have in this database to remember info on each user? Two, right? Username, password, probably. So it's like creating the fancier version of a spreadsheet with two fields. And now we have the two fields. I can define the username field and the password field. And then you'll see in this dropdown, and this is why PHP MyAdmin is sort of pedagogically compelling, it actually prompts you with a lot of the available options. And there's a whole bunch of different data types in not only SQL itself, but specifically in MySQL, some of which we'll tease apart over time. Perhaps the most useful one for tonight's purposes is this thing called varchar, in contrast to char. So there's this char field, a char data type, which can be a character string from 0 to 255 characters. But it pre-allocates space. So if you specify that this field is going to be 255 characters, that's how much memory is reserved on disk for this string. And it's just padded with null characters if the string is shorter. Varchar is a little fancier. It's like a dynamic string where you specify just the maximum length for the field. So I'm actually going to say that usernames and passwords will be no longer than 8 characters. So we can argue another day as to whether or not that's enough. And I'm just defining now two columns, username, password, each of whose length is going to be 8. If I scroll over now to the right, there's a few different features here. But really important for now is that I don't want any bogus data to end up in my database. So I'm going to make sure that neither of these fields is allowed to be null, so that if I actually get around to implementing like a registration capability, I won't get like null passwords, which are pretty insecure, or worse, null usernames, which would just be strange. So I'm going to leave those at not null. And then there's a bunch of fields here, which we'll talk about more in particular next week. But there's this notion also with a database of keys. And a key is simply a column that should be used typically to look up data in the database. So what's a common query for what we're trying to create here? Well, if we just want two columns, username and password, it's probably going to be pretty common for us to query data based on what specifically? At least the username, right? Because I conceptually, I'm probably going to ask when a user tries to log into my website, get all of the information I have in my database on username equals quote unquote J Harvard and get that back. So one of the things you can do, and again, we'll talk about this more over time for performance reasons, is give hints to MySQL saying, you know what, optimize yourself by making this field username a key so that it lays out in memory whatever B-tree structure or binary tree or hash table, whatever it's using to just optimize queries based on username. So it's good not for, you know, simple demos, but certainly when you start talking hundreds and thousands and more pieces of data. So I'll do that for now. I don't want to say that passwords must be unique too, or must be the icon I've clicked actually says this is a primary key. And long story short, a primary key is not only used to look up data, but it must be unique across all rows in the database for reasons we'll revisit next week. I don't want to say that a password has to be a primary key, because what would be the implication otherwise?
Two different people couldn't have the same password.
Right. Two different people couldn't have the same password, and that would also be a weird thing, if nothing else, and creates undue problems. So let's go ahead and save this. And notice that what really phpMyAdmin did was just created the set of SQL statements that would achieve the task at hand. So if I actually copied that and went over using SSH to a window that looks like this by simply typing at the command line of cs75.net, MySQL, and then a few different switches like user equals mail and test, password, and then typing in password. What I could actually have done is taken something like this, this SQL syntax, and I suspect the paste will get a little ugly here. I could have pasted this in, hit enter, and done all of this at the command line. But it very quickly becomes tedious to type out that much syntax. The GUI is quite nice, though certainly not requisite. All right, so what do I now have? Well, if I get rid of freshen things up, I now have a table called users, a whole bunch of options, which you can certainly play around with to get familiar with. But for our purposes, all this is saying is now I have an empty table called users. So let's actually insert some data into it. All right, you can do this in a couple of ways. Frankly, the simplest way is when I click on that database's name, I'll actually see the fields and I'll be reminded of what type it is and whether or not it can be null and so forth. What phpMyAdmin does, if I click insert, I can actually fill in a form and just populate rows in the database this way. And again, this isn't an inherent feature of a relational database. It's just a nice GUI with which to do this. But I can type in J Harvard and password. And what we'll see upon inserting this sample data into our database is that Crimson will be his password. What really was executed is this. So insert into, and I'll make this a bit bigger. This is typical insert syntax. So insert into database name dot table name, parentheses, the two fields that you want to insert, followed by values, followed by parentheses, and then with commas separating them, the actual values that you want to give for each of those fields. So the funky quote marks are a phpMyAdmin thing for escaping reasons. So you actually don't typically need all of these quote marks, and specifically not the backtick quote marks. But we'll come back to that more next week too when we execute other commands. But just to be clear, you know what? Now I can click browse, because what phpMyAdmin is going to show me now is the contents of my Excel spreadsheet equivalent in this tabular form. It has in fact been inserted there. So if I wanted to create another row, I could go to the Insert tab here and maybe create a Jane Harvard account and give her a password. Or what's more nice about phpMyAdmin is you can execute arbitrary SQL queries. And this is where it becomes useful for development and testing purposes. I'm going to go ahead and do Insert into, I know what database I'm on by default, so I only have to specify the table name. Insert into users, the username, password fields, the following values. Jane, followed by, we'll give her the same password because we can. Go. And it apparently has inserted one row as well. So if I now browse in this interface, I now see two rows in my database table, and so forth. So the point now, though, is that we have a database server. We provide that to you. We have a database which you can create for yourselves using the panel. We now have a table in here called users with two fields, and we have some sample data. So now we have sort of the building blocks in place with which we can actually finish implementing this login functionality. Recall that we left off at this point in the story. We got rid of our constants. So how can I actually now check if the user has given a valid username and password? Well, if he submitted via post a user and pass field, I'm going to do the following. First, I'm going to construct a string. And a very useful thing is sprintf in PHP, because you can keep your strings a little neater than if you had to do a lot of concatenation again and again. So this is a common trick. It's not necessary. But all I'm creating with sprintf here is a string. That is, select star from users, where user equals quote unquote percent s, where percent s a la printf is a placeholder for a string. So I have a comma, and then this annoyingly named function, MySQL real escape string, is the function you should call to ensure that you're avoiding SQL injection attacks, which we'll come back to in a second. But what that is doing is effectively massaging the data to make sure someone hasn't submitted like delete from star into the username field, thereby tricking your code to executing a query as opposed to looking up a username. But we'll spend more time on that when we discuss security. But notice that really all this is doing is creating a string that is select star from users where user equals quote unquote J Harvard, hopefully. In fact, let's prove as much. So here is that form. Let's type in J Harvard Crimson. But let me change this code here right after I construct this string and just print out the SQL command, the SQL string, and then exit. All right, this is sort of testing on the fly. This is login 5.php. So let me actually pull up the right one. So J Harvard Crimson, enter. So all sprintf is created is that. Okay, and you don't have to use sprintf to be clear. You could use the dot operator and so forth. Just keeps things clean and allows you to call MySQL real escape string in a slightly neater fashion. But now let's actually do something with this. So now I have a string, which, assuming I've done things correctly, is a valid SQL query. If I went ahead and typed that thing incidentally into PHP MyAdmin, which is actually really nice to do during development, I can do a sanity check. Is that correct? Right? So I can click go. And in fact, unknown column user. All right, so there's a disconnect here. Because I deleted my prefab database tables, what I actually did apparently for the demo was I actually defined the username field to be just user. So we can fix that. Let's go back to the users table, the structure tab. And now all these little pencils and X's, well, the pencil means edit this field. So let's go ahead and edit the field name without affecting the data. The table users has been altered. Now let's go back over here. And we'll see that if we execute that same string into PHP MyAdmin in its SQL tab, good. So now we got back one total result, and it's just this particular row, which was as expected. Yeah? I should for the next example, but this one I don't think it'll affect it because I'm not actually. Oh, you know what? I am, because I'm querying star. So let's do that too. So let's go into structure real quick. Let's click the pencil.
Not according to this source.
Not according
to this source? Oh, yes. Good. All right. Then we're still good to go. All right, so what happens now? So all I did now was sort of pretend to execute that query. Well, I did execute that query, but in the wrong context. Now let's actually execute it within the code itself. And as promised, MySQL query is the function that uses that existing database connection that we opened earlier, sends this query along, and gets back effectively an array of results. But not quite an array. There's a bit of trickery involved. But let's take a look. So we get back a result variable, which isn't, we get back a result variable, which if it equals false, something went wrong. It doesn't mean we got back no data. It means something went wrong, like the connection died, or it was an invalid username password in the first. So I'm checking for false just to see, did the query at least execute? If so, we get to this point, and I'm going to check. Well, if the number of rows returned in this so-called result set, So much like XPath returns this notion of a node set, a collection of objects, so does the SQL query return a result set, which itself might contain zero or more rows from the database. So if the number of rows in that result set equals one, that's a good thing, because it means we found the user called J Harvard. So in that case, what I'm going to do is fetch the first row from that result. So this function here, MySQL fetch associative, means fetch as an associative array that row in the database, or that row in the table. And by associative array, what I mean here is we're going to get back an array that has a bunch of fields. One's called user, one's called password, as opposed to just a normal array, which means I would have to remember that the very first column in my table was back at first, the one was the password field, so that dollar sign row bracket one. So there's another function called MySQL fetch array, which returns that construct, which is actually a little better performance-wise, but it's conceptually is not as straightforward, certainly not for simple demos. So I'm going to fetch a row, and now I'm going to check if the password field in this associative array equals what the user typed in. The implication is that we should let this guy through. So let's remember that he's authenticated, and let's go ahead and redirect. And if anything else happens, clearly something went wrong, let's just display the form again with some of the features we've discussed thus far. So in short, with just a few lines of code and a few clicks with our PHP MyAdmin interface, we've created the database account, the database table. We've manually inserted some test data. Now we're authenticating against that database as opposed to those hard-coded constants. So pretty neat, but doesn't totally solve that first problem at hand. But before we dive back to this, any questions? Yes? The percent S, yes. So if you Google printf format strings or just look at the documentation for sprintf or printf in PHP, there's just standard symbols like percent S, percent D, percent C, which mean string, character, integer, and so forth. It's a placeholder derived from C or maybe even earlier. Yeah. Excellent question. So on some systems, so in your file called php.ini, which is PHP's config file, there's actually an option you can specify that says by default that function, MySQL fetch array, should return either a normal array or an associative array. So it sounds like your system just has the latter enabled by default. So other questions? Yeah? What's the data type here? So it's an object of some type. I would have to actually look at the man page for MySQL Connect. But for the
How does the page know about all the SQL functions?
Where do these functions come from? With PHP 5, you get them for free, so to speak. There's no required library. There's no include. They're just come with PHP. And this, again, speaks to sort of this fundamental relationship between PHP and web development and MySQL development. Yeah?
I assume this depends on the default. If your server is configured to return an associative array by default, and you count on that and then run the PHP script on another server, is it exactly?
Yes. So you can MySQL fetch associative array will always return an associative array. And I do think there's a way to avoid problems with the more generic MySQL fetch array. I think it either constructs it in such a way you can do both, or if not, there's, I think, yet a third version that's predictably numeric based as opposed to configurable. So. So there's a second argument that allows you, I presume, to specify explicitly what type of array to get back. Oh, okay. So now you get back both if you want. Okay.
Connection is a resource.
If you types, so to speak, that can be returned, but it's still fairly generic in nature. So there is a gotcha here. Those of you thinking with sort of a security hat in mind, what is stupid about this design? Probably not uncommon either in certain websites.
The password is stored in plain text.
Password stored in plain text, implication of which is what? Right. So in this world of privacy concerns, lawsuits, and whatnot, one guy gets into a database like this and now has the usernames and passwords of everyone, which maybe for a simple play site, not such a big deal, but you still serious privacy implications and legal liabilities potentially, and two, odds are a lot of those users probably use those same passwords on PayPal or bankofamerica.com or the like. So there's these immediate implications. So what is perhaps an immediate solution to that problem? Don't store the clear text, but I'm sorry? So create a primary key is a solution to a different problem. Creating the primary key just tells MySQL to optimize itself for queries based on that field. So more simply, the goal at hand is
at least encrypt the password,
right? Whip out your ROT13 skills, whip out a password function or something more strong. And in fact, here too, SQL and MySQL specifically sort of come to the rescue, at least to some extent. So it turns out that in login 7.php, I'm going to skip 6 for now, we're making two modifications here. For different reasons. So in login 7.php, most of the code is identical because I've just added one new feature here just to point out a useful trick. There really was no reason for me to select that entire row from my database, small as it is, because this is a database and in principle it's supposed to be optimized for looking up data. And yet I'm sort of reinventing a wheel here, small wheel, but if I'm just selecting the password from the database so that I can then do equals equals in my code, well, why didn't I just let the database do that? And the here doesn't really matter, it's a small example, but when you're trying to do lookups, why don't I just punt and let the database just return a true or false? Is this username password in the database? And so a useful trick is actually to select constant data from a SQL table. It almost seems silly on first glance, but if I just select now one from the table called users in the middle of the screen here, where user equals %s and pass equals effectively %s, then this query will return one row with one column containing the number 1. No rows whatsoever, both of which conditions I can check. Because before, remember, I checked if the number of rows equals 1, well, the implication, because of how I've constructed that query, is that the only condition on which I'll get one row back, silly as the data is, it's just one column with the number 1, will be if username and password match the database. Yeah?
If the password's wrong, or the username is wrong, and so it returns nothing, won't that make the execute query hard? Won't that be false and therefore come back and say could not query the database?
No. So to summarize, what if that does in fact return 0 rows because the username and or password are wrong? False is only returned if you look at the manual specifically under cases of error. And just getting back no data is not an error. It's just a very empty result. So this is for errors. It doesn't check the number of rows, which we check with this trick or with any number of others. But there's one other trick that I'm doing up here, which is actually calling a function called password. So this is going to be one of these things where we preach it for just like 20 seconds and then take it away because it's not secure. So the password function is not terribly secure, but it does come for free with MySQL, whereby it creates a one-way hash. It is a one-way hash, so it takes a password and creates a semi-random string that's not mathematically is really hard, if not impossible, to take to the original value. So what this means is what would be better if I want a modicum of security here is actually when I insert these users, whom I'm now going to delete for a moment by clicking the X field, when I insert, what I really want to do is this. So insert into users, user password, the values J Harvard, followed by the return value of this built-in function called password with a parameter of crimson. So what I'm really faking now is the whole registration module to this website just by using phpMyAdmin. But if I insert that, and now browse my tables, notice that it's this, you know, semi-random looking string. The password field is now *02 alpha 501 bravo. So not the clear text password, which means if a hacker stole my whole database, he's not going to see clear text passwords anymore. Now, in theory, he could still do his sort of brute force dictionary attack and figure out people's passwords. But at least now we've made some effort to hide that data and protect it. So what do we now do in the query? Well, we can't reverse that encryption because it's a hash. It's not really encryption. It's a hash. You can go one direction, but not the other. But what I can do is the same way, same function, and then compare. So that gets us around the problem of storing the password in clear text. And so the query just changes now so that I'm checking not only the username, but in this case, the password. And here, too, is why I personally just like using sprintf, because it allows you just to neatly put in these placeholders, keep the string very readable, and then plug in the values. And we'll talk next week, incidentally, about this escaping. But let's do one step better, because again, I promise we have to take this function away from you now. So in login 8, almost identical, we're using a better function called AES encrypt. So AES encrypt also comes with newer versions of MySQL, and it is in the top right corner there. The usage is a little different. You have to pass it both the string to encrypt, but also a key. So here too, and going rather quickly over security implications, I could just choose a very secret password that only I, the webmaster, knows, and just encrypt everyone's password with my same key, which is just some really long cryptic password that only I have written down on a post-it note. And I unfortunately have to hard code it, though, into my program somewhere. So a couple downsides. One, now if someone steals not only my database dump, but also my code, now they can decrypt all the passwords. Kind of lame, not really much of an improvement. So maybe better than storing, like I have, and it's unfortunately wrapping, secret as my key, you can actually do other tricks, which I would defer discussion of really to a crypto class. But you can, for instance, encrypt the user's password with maybe their own password. Maybe their own password concatenated with the equivalent of what's called a salt, like the username concatenated with the password can be the key. The point being, though, for tonight, that don't use a hard-coded password. If you encrypt the user's password with, say, their password, you don't even need to get in the middle now. Because AES encrypt is a two-way cipher, you can encrypt and decrypt. This way, so long as the user's providing the right value, you can check that their password is correct by just encrypting it with the same scheme. But I kept it simple. And I'm just using a secret key of secret for tonight's purposes. We'll spend a little more time perhaps in section on the crypto implications. But other than that, login 8 is pretty much the same in terms of login capabilities. Yeah?
This is bothering me from login 1.
Huh?
Where we started with SQL.
Mm-hmm.
For making your connection to MySQL, you got to hard code in, or you have to hard code it in your password to the MySQL database. Is there a way around that?
Good, really good question. So in my printouts, I actually deleted most of the credentials just because. Short answer, no. This is really a nuisance of typical PHP frameworks whereby you either have to hard code into your source code the username password to use, or maybe a little more intelligently use constants that are defined somewhere centrally. But at the end of the day, yeah, those credentials do need to be stored somewhere unless with your database you've configured it maybe to allow connections from any username but from a specific IP address or only from localhost. So there's a few ways to mitigate this, but almost every software package I've ever seen online that you download, like Forum, just has like a config.php file where you paste in the username and password. But you have to be careful there because if someone compromises that file, you know, sort of all bets are off as to the data that you've been using. I'm sorry? At least you can hide in one central file and be a little more vigilant about the permissions and the path that that file is in. So we have this hanging detail here. We seem now to have sort of revamped our whole authentication module, not to use these constants, but actually to have a database framework. But still, we need that checkbox back. And that checkbox, recall, we decided was going to maintain some kind of long pseudo-random. Oh, I pulled out the names from those constants. Ah, see, that's what happened. I delete the usernames and passwords. None of them work. So really, the end game here was to create, watch this thing. So the where we'll begin, I think, next week is now we have a database. We're going to need another table. We're going to need to remember these tokens that we described earlier and come up with a clever scheme for that. So we'll do that next week and also take things up a notch with multiple tables, doing joins, and some more sophisticated SQL syntax. So we'll see you in a week.